Okay. What's up, Nawak? We are so excited you guys are here with us this weekend.
Nawak, what's up? Welcome to week three of our series, This Is For You.
Yeah, and speaking of our This Is For You series, we've had a lot going on. So tell me, Noah, what is your favorite part so far?
It's been so incredible. We've had incredible moments of worship each week, and we've had incredible messages that are just relevant to our age. And we've had something special going on. At the front of the door, if you walk in, you're gonna see something that is a specialty coffee bar. And it's just specialty coffee. It's Mountaineer Coffee out of Brooksville, Florida. We're serving it, special pour over. We're making it. I'll be there this weekend making it, especially for you. I won't be on the stage, but I'll be back there, and I can't wait to see you. And that's what's going on right here. If we'd love it if you could be here. We understand if you can't, so that means I hope you're watching online. And if you are watching online, we have hosts that are ready to talk to you. They're there, they're bored. You can bug them, annoy them, because they're not going anywhere. They can't leave. We told them you gotta stay there no matter what happens, so they'll be there ready to talk to you.
Yeah, so that's getting to know a little bit more about you at home, but we'd love to tell you some more about ourselves. So Noah, tell me, what do you do around this place?
Yeah, I get to lead worship here. It's such a privilege. You might see me on the weekends, even with our students. I love working with the kids. It's incredible just pushing people into times of worship with the Lord. And when I'm not here, I love to cook. I love to read. And I also love my mom a whole lot. Shout out, Mom.
Woo.
Ashley, what about you?
So I am one of our kids ministry residents here at Nawak. So you'll see me a lot in the kids ministry, walking around, making sure our kiddos are having a good time and staying safe while doing it. I also get to work a lot with our volunteers and just making sure that they're set and ready to go for the weekend as well. So I love doing that. And if you see me at all, I would love to say hi. But now I'm going to tell you a little bit more about a big event we have coming up soon, New Steps. So we're offering New Steps on August 30th. We're offering it online and on campus. So go ahead and register online if you're ready. Or just go ahead and show up. Our New Steps is our disciple classes that help you go deeper into your faith and just learn a little bit more spiritually.
That's great. You gotta be there. I'll be there. I'm gonna be in New Steps 201, just a baby in the New Steps process, but I'm gonna be there. And another thing that we wanna talk about is prayer. We think prayer is so powerful and so important. It's a part of our daily walk with Jesus in our Christian life. So if you are online or you're here, there's three ways that you could pray. You could pray with us via online. You can pray with us by filling out a Connect card, or if you need immediate prayer, there's gonna be a text number right here that you can just text it, and as soon as possible, you'll get a response back, which means we will be praying for you immediately. We don't want you to wait any longer, so go ahead. If you need it, go and directly text that number.
Yeah, so now we would love to shout out a super important people to us. These are our VIPs. So we are so glad that you guys are here. Our VIPs are our first and second time visitors. So if you're watching from home, go ahead and tell us where you're from, maybe what room you're watching from, or even just comment your favorite emoji. We'd love to get to know you a little bit more.
We love our VIPs, but now we're going into a time of worship. It's gonna be incredible. Worship is our time where the Lord gets to minister to us and we get to do the same to him, and it's incredible. We get to do it every weekend. We get to do it on Wednesday with our students, but right here, right now, we want you to be able to take advantage of that connection with the Lord, because it's there and it's open to you and it's free and he is waiting for you. So don't let this just be background music. Even if you're driving, even if you're just sitting at home, I challenge you just to change your posture a little bit, you know? Change just the mental space that you're in right now, and just get ready to connect with the Lord in a new and fresh way.
Yeah. So worship is just getting ready to start in just a few seconds. So we would love it if you would just go ahead and join me and Noah. We're going to be worshiping, and we just love it if you could join us. So, all right, let's go.
Good morning, Nawak Church. Would you stand to your feet? We're going to worship God this morning. My sin is gone. My shame is dead and gone. Let's sing this together. Come on. That you shed your blood, so I'm gonna live like my shame is gone. I won't be shackled to the way I was. Oh, I'm gonna live like my chains are gone, gone. Now my sin is dead and gone, and I sing hallelujah. And we sing done, done. That'll overcome.
Church, we're going to share a new song with you guys this morning. This song says something very simple. This song says that, God, when you call me, whatever you need, I'm available. Wherever you need me to go, whatever you need me to do, Lord, I'm available. Here I am. Send me.
Yeah.
before you, we can enter into your throne room and sit at your feet and just worship you, Lord. Father, we're so thankful. We're thankful that we can do that. We can freely worship as your children. But God, as we continue in this time, Lord, I want to lift up Pastor Gary as he comes out here to deliver the word. God, I pray you give him wisdom. God, I pray that you give us hearts to hear what he has to say. And Lord, we want to hear from you. So Father, we ask that you move mightily here this morning at New Walk Church. We love you. We thank you for the cross, for how it sets us free. And we thank you for Jesus. Lord, it's in his precious name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much for worshiping with us this morning, church. You guys can be seated.
What's up, New Walk? We are so excited that you guys are here with us today. My name's Ashley.
Hey, I'm Noah, and welcome to week 3 of our series, This Is For You.
Yeah, so we want to take a second to welcome a very special group of people to us. These are our VIPs. We are so excited that you guys are here. Our VIPs are our first and second time guests, and we would just love to connect with you. So if you're watching from online, go ahead and let us know in the chat box. Let our host know that you're here and maybe where you're watching from.
We love our online people, we love our VIPs, but if you're here in person, we also want to get to know you. So would you fill out just the Connect card that you get on your way in? Lets us know just a little bit about you so we can tell you a little bit more about us.
Yeah, and we have a really big event coming up. It's called our New Step Classes. So our New Step Classes are discipleship classes that allow you to go deeper in your faith. We're offering those on campus on August 30th, as well as online August 30th, and you can go ahead and register on our website.
Shout out New Steps, we're so glad we're going to be there. I'm going to be there going through 201. And it's incredibly important to our church that you show up just to know a little bit more about who we are and why we do what we do. Another thing that's vitally important to us is prayer. Prayer is so good. It's a direct connection to be able to speak to the one who created us, who created everything. So we don't want to miss that. We don't want to take that for granted. And there's 3 ways that you can pray with us. The first way to pray is by filling out your Connect card. The second way to pray is by going online. And then the third way to pray is with this phone number right here. It's a direct connection to us, so we can pray for you as soon as possible.
Yeah, and so now we want to talk a little bit about giving. We are so thankful for all of you that have continued to give through this time, and we just want to invite you to continue giving or even begin giving, and we have 5 options for you guys. You probably see those instead of my face right now, but that's just because it's so important. We cannot do this without you guys. So we just want to thank you again for giving to New Walk Church.
Amen. We love you guys. We're thankful for you. Get ready. This is week 3 of our series. Pastor Gary, take it away.
It's not time to be silent, don't you dare.
Good morning, New Walk. Hey, glad you're here with us. We've got a group of people watching online. We're glad they are with us as well. And we are basically one church in 2 different settings right now, an online group and a live group. Let's do another little cheering for the group watching online. Let's give it up for them. Thank you so much for being with us. We are in the 3rd week, as video said, of our series, This Is For You. Before I get into that, I want to let you know about something we dealt with maybe about a year ago at our church, where we were inviting you to go on a trip to Israel with us. That trip is still on. It's in April. That's 8 months away. As we know, a lot can change in 8 months, but right now, the organization that leads that telling us that the plan is that trips would be on by that point. And again, a little bit of variables along the way, but we still have something like 30 people signed up for this trip, going on this trip, and our goal was to get between 35 to 40. So we have a handful of spots left. If you are interested in going on that trip to Israel, we would love to have you. As my wife, Sean, and I, we're going to be leading that trip, and we go, it's about a 10-day from the time we leave and the time we get back home. It's about 10 days total, somewhere about. And we'd love to have you be a part of it. This is, again, mid to late April is when this is taking place. If you are interested, you're watching online, you're interested, you're here live, you're interested being a part of this trip. We have people that are giving, and if it turns out the trip is canceled, they get refunded as far as the cancellation of the trip. However, for those of you that are interested in seeing a little more information about it, you can write Israel on your Connect card online. Here in service, you can write it on your Connect card, write Israel, circle it, drop it in the offering bucket on your way out. We'll put you in a queue to give you a little information about it. We'll also put you in the very same queue for information about a gathering coming up in 3 weeks here on a Sunday after church. I'm going to give a little presentation about everything that's available on that trip, what you're going to see, what you're going to encounter. Maybe you think, I'm not going on that trip, but you just want to see all the cool things that are to be seen over there that we saw. We'll share some of those things with you. But an informational gathering in 3 weeks, September the 6th, right here at church. If you're interested, again, write Israel online on your Connect card or here in service. It's going to be a really great trip if we are able to actually see that trip happen. Our series, as you know, came from the heart of our young adults, and they gathered with me in a creative session, and they listed out some of the things they wanted to hear about. And one of the things they are dealing with, struggling with, and I think all of us are dealing with this when you get down to it, is, Pastor Gary, when is it good to speak out? When is it good to take a stand? When is it good to decide, you know what, I need to be a difference maker in this moment? And this generation, people that are out of high school, some high schoolers, but out of high school, of course, in that college age group, or all the way up to age 29, never been more interested in being activists for things. You know, there's a lot of energy with that, and so I understand that, but I also understand that when you speak out, that people come at you, especially these days, right? You're going to speak out, and people are get upset, cancel culture, all that stuff. You know, it's like, okay, you're really going to take a stand. You got to be ready for some of those things as well. And so they understand that. You understand that that can be a challenge. So then, if it is a challenge, how do we handle that? I'm going to give you a little information, I think, today to help with that. And one of the things that I do to oftentimes filter, is this a good time to speak up and speak out? Is this an important time to say something? Is I always run it through, like, the heart of it, where it's coming from. Is this coming from a place that is unhealthy or a place that is healthy? And I actually wrote in your notes, it's sort of an understanding of oftentimes this comes from anger. Like when we see things happening in our world, in our country that bother us, we get angry and then we just say, I need to do something, I need to say something about what's going on. And so that anger is sometimes where it happens. So then how do I determine if it's a healthy anger? Where is it coming from? And two types of anger you're always going to have to filter through. One is unrighteous anger, and one is a righteous anger. There's clearly a difference. The Bible gives us examples of righteous anger, but we also know there's an unhealthy anger as well. There's an anger that leads to sinful behavior, and it's born out of toxicity inside, and it has unhealthy outcomes. There's another anger that's born out of, like, a frustration. There's a healthy anger born out of a frustration for seeing people do things that strike at the heart of what God would be against. And then we go, okay, now I want to say something there. And that is being involved in righteous anger. Ephesians 4:26, it says, you can be angry, but do not sin. Be angry, but do not sin. All right, so, you know, Jesus, he walks into the temple courts, and they're exchanging money at the changing tables and kind of making a mockery of some things that are happening there in the temple, and he gets angry, he flips over the tables, right? Because this is going against the heart of God, the heart of God at the temple. This is an unhealthy thing, and he sees it, and he's like, this is not pleasing to God. And so he understands that this is a righteous moment. This is a rightful thing, and I put in your notes, being angered in your heart for the things that anger God. That is righteous anger. And so when I'm seeing things going on, I'm filtering it. Is this something that God clearly speaks about in His Word that I know is against, you know, it's like this is not something He is for, and so I'm going to help speak out into that situation? Because I do think we get caught up spinning our wheels and expending a lot of energy in things that are born out of toxicity in our heart. Sinful anger. And that's not really going to be a difference maker in the world. This ability to use what God has given you to make a difference, there's a word that describes it, all of it, and what we're going to be dealing with today. It's called influence. And I put in my notes, it's not in yours, but from the Cambridge Dictionary, the definition of influence is this. It is the power to affect how someone develops, acts, or thinks. And when you say, I want to speak out and make a difference, what you're saying is, I'm upset with the way somebody is acting, thinking, developing a mindset, living out something in their life, and so I feel the need to speak out. You are saying is, I want to influence somebody to live differently, to act differently, behave differently in their life. And this is important. Believers are called to be influencers. We absolutely are. You're not called to sit on the sidelines and go, well, I'm not going to just do anything, you know, I'm not just going to be an influencer. No, you, believers are called to be influencers. The Bible tells us this over and over again. In Matthew chapter 5 and verse 16, it says, let your light shine. Why? So that others, let your light shine so that others will see the good that you do, the good things that bring praise to the Heavenly Father, the Father in heaven. Let God be made known to others by the way that you are living in your life. The light that you've been given is not meant to be covered up. It is meant to shine. And a part of shining for Christ is letting people see the things that are good, things that bring glory to God. In another scripture, not far off of that one, a little bit before, it says this. It says, you are like salt for the whole world. What does salt do in this world? When we think about salt, it seasons, it adds flavor, it brings a preservative, right? So like, as believers, we're being told, hey, bring those things to this world, add a little flavor, add a little bit to it, you know, get involved in some things as people who are believers. In Jeremiah, it says this in 15 and 19, you are to influence them, do not let them influence you. Impacting people, making a difference, is something that we are supposed to do as a believer. Now, there are a lot of things we could get involved in, and we live in a time now where everybody's trying to get involved in all kinds of interesting things going on. But if I'm looking at filters of where I could spend my energy, I put some things in your notes. Like there's all kinds of things that people want to be involved in. I want to share with you, though, where I kind of put my focus as a believer. Because you came to church, you're listening to the preacher. The preacher's going to tell you where to put your energy as a believer. I'm speaking about that strength and that courage as a believer in Christ and making the most difference. So I put in your notes, I could get involved in political change. That's nice, you know. And what does politics do? It tries to change what people do through laws, through law. And, you know, oftentimes politics is really too late. You know, something bad starts happening, and so they pass laws to try to correct people and their behaviors and the way that they're doing things. But in the end, it doesn't really go to the heart of humans, but it's nice if you want to be involved in politics. That's great. But that's not what I'm going to talk to you about as a believer. That's not where you can put your greatest influence. There's educational. That changes what people know. And I think it's very nice to be in education. People feel very called to that, being an influencer that way, and I think that's wonderful. It's knowledge, and oftentimes, you know, much of our education, as I reference the school system, very much a head knowledge for living in this world. But again, as a preacher, and not just as a preacher, as a believer in Christ, we're talking about how, as a believer, we can be difference makers. How about material things? This is affecting people's the things that they have, like money and resources. Psychological change changes what people feel. Sociological change changes how people relate. Biological change changes in people's bodies. And then there's biblical change, changing of the heart. This is where I would tell you that if you've got a righteous anger and you've got something that bothers you and it goes in alignment with the Bible and it can affect the human heart, my goodness, as believers, wouldn't we want to put most of our energy in that? Like, if we were going to take a stand, wouldn't it be for the things like that And so that's what I'm talking to you about here in our time together. And so what we're going to do is we're going to learn the art of influence to affect change as a believer. I want to share with you a little bit, three things, some things that I know about the heart of the art of influence. And here's what I put in your notes. The first thing is this: as a believer, I have got to recognize, of course, that I have influence already. Because there shouldn't be anybody sitting here that's a believer in Christ going, I don't know if I have any influence. No, we all have influence. We know this, right? Every day when you wake up, you have opportunities to influence your neighbors, to influence your friends, to influence relatives. When you go to school, your classmates, you can bring influence to them. When you're at work, you can influence your coworkers, boyfriends, girlfriends, husbands, wives. You're in a small group. You have an opportunity in your small group to bring influence. You're on a serve team. You have an opportunity to be influential on your serve team. You play a sport with teammates. You have an opportunity to be influential in sports with teammates. You're a soccer mom. Hey, you can influence other soccer moms. You're a little league dad. You can influence that team, the coaches, parents as well. You are an influencer when you go check out at a place, in the line, the cashier, the clerk checks you out. And just the way you treat them and talk to them, you can change their day through influence. Postal workers, barbers, bankers, people in stores, people you're passing by online through social media posts, you have influence. When you make a phone call, when you reply to a text on some texting or platform that you use to write people back, or when you write an email response to your boss or coworkers, these are all opportunities to be influential. So the question is not, do we have influence? The question is, how are you using your influence now? Hey, look, this goes back to the question, when people get you, what do they get when they get you every day? Do they get a healthy influence on their life, or is it an unhealthy influence on their life? Because we are to be influencers, and this comes down to really focusing now on, okay, what has God given me right now to utilize in my life? Because I think sometimes what we think about when we want to be a difference maker, when we want to speak out and we want to influence people, we go to these grandiose things, kind of big things that we want to be involved in, and I think that's very nice. But I think God would say to you, like, well, what are you doing now with what you have? This is stewardship, right? The Bible talks about this. It talks about, I got to do well with what I have right now before I, you know, go beyond that sphere of influence. And so I go back to, hey, you want to be a difference maker? How are you dealing with the things that you have now? Galatians 6:4 says this: make a careful exploration of who you are, the work that you have been given, and then sink into it. I know who I am, I know what God has called me to do, and now I'm going to sink in to that. That's a portrait of doing well with what we have, with what we have now. This question is asked, really, this great question of all, one of the great questions in all of humanity is asked of Moses by God. You know, Moses goes out to the burning bush, you know, and he's dealing with some things that are upsetting him, and God speaks out to him and says this question to Moses. He says, Moses, what is in your hand? What is in your hand? In fact, here's the dialogue in Exodus 4 and verse 2. The Lord said to Moses, what is in your hand? A staff, he replied. God said, throw it on the ground. He's got, what was in his hand? It was a staff. This staff was used as a shepherd. He's guiding the sheep around. And, you know, God says, okay, now I want you to take that staff and I want you to throw it on the ground. It becomes a snake. It comes alive. It has power to it. Whoa, this is kind of interesting. You're looking at something that just seems very ordinary. And now God is showing Moses, look how incredible just something of a staff can be. He takes it back. It becomes a staff again. What was God doing in that moment asking Moses, what's in your hand? What he was saying is, Moses, you are upset. Moses, you are dealing with some things. Hey, Moses, you want to be a difference maker, which we know Moses became a difference maker. You want to be a difference maker? What is in your hand right now? That staff represented his income. That staff represented his identity. That staff represented his influence. You could look at it and say it's just a measly old staff to guide little sheepies around. God was saying no to Moses. Look, everything you have is right there available to you now. What do you have in your hand? And that's what I want to ask you today. What do you have in your hand? In other words, what do you have now in your hand to be an influencer to people? What settings, what situations do you have right now to be a difference maker? Moses became a difference maker, starting with what he had in his hand. What talents do you have right now? What contacts do you have? What relationships do you have? What skill sets has God given you to do something with now? You say you want to be a difference maker. Let's take a closer examination, if you don't mind, really, of what we are doing well with already. Influence really starts with an understanding that, hey, we all do have it. We all have an influence. And so not only do we recognize, that's the first thing, and the next thing is exercise. We recognize we have influence and we exercise. And when I say exercise, what I mean is we're talking about putting it to work. We have it, so we're putting it to work. And utilizing your influence is like your muscles. Like if you activate your muscles and you're using your muscles constantly, they will strengthen, they will be healthy, they will grow because you're putting them to work. But with our muscles, it's kind of sometimes it's like use it or lose it, you understand? The same thing is true for us when it relates to our influence. It's use it or lose it, bro. You put it into use or lose it, because God has trusted you to absolutely be an influencer. What I thought I would do, though, is if you're going to exercise your influence, think about these things when it comes to influence. And so I put these in your notes. I got five of them. The first thing is this. One way to exercise influence is by loving people. I know it's very popular to write an opinion online, but you understand that real influence comes when people know that you care about them. I mean, really, come on. If somebody's barfing on you with some sort of opinion, you're not really, you know this. You know this. I hope you know this when you post it, and I hope you know this when you're reading it. It's like, if it's not coming from a place of love and care, it's really to be heavily discounted. I know it would be for me as well. I love what Teddy Roosevelt said. He said it like this: people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And when they know how much you care, they start to listen. You can influence people when they know that you love them, when they know that you care. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 in the love chapter, it says this. It says, if I speak in tongues of men or of angels, but I don't have love, you know what I'm doing? Look, I'm only like a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. It's just noise. If I have the gift of prophecy and I can fathom all the mysteries and all the knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains, but I don't have love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and I give over my body to hardship that I may boast, but I don't have love, he says, I gain what? Nothing. Oh, you want to make a difference? It starts with love. That's what Paul is saying. We're talking about encouraging people. We're talking about building one another up. We're talking about a love that is strengthening people. You know, it's coming along by their side in the good times and in the bad. And that's really critical, too, to remember when it comes to influence. Like, it's one thing to roll with your buddies and be real excited with your buddies when your buddies are on a mountaintop. But what about caring about people when they're in their lowest? That's where you can really show how much you really care. And I would say, by the way, church, this is the time that the Christians ought to be exercising their influence now more than ever, because right now more people are hurting than ever before. And if we will get into those hurts and into those struggles and care about them where they are in the low places, they will see that we love them, they will see that they care, and now we can exercise an influence because they know that we love them. I wonder how you're doing with this. I love what it says in 2 Corinthians 1:4. God comforts us. He comforts us. Why? So when others have trouble, we can comfort them with the same comfort that God gives us. When God came alongside you in a very difficult time in your life and he comforted you, he showed you in a moment exactly what we ought to be doing as believers, coming alongside other people who are hurting and now utilizing that skill set to comfort them. It opens up the door for influence when you're there, invested in their life, especially difficult times in their life. Are you sympathizing, empathizing, caring, showing a caring behavior towards people that are hurting? Are you loving them? There's a lot of people who need to know that you love them. And I say this, I struggle with this. There's a lot of people that I love, but I don't always do a good job of telling them that I love them or letting them know that I love them. And I think we struggle with this at times, but we're trying to make a difference. We got to let some people know that we love them. And here's the next thing in your notes: serving people. Okay. You want to make a difference. You want to be a difference maker. You want to speak out. You want to be loud. You want to make an impact. Are you serving people? See, this thing builds a little bit. You see that it's more than just saying I want to speak out, but I don't want it to just be a vomit on people. I want it to actually mean something. And so I'm just saying to you, okay, well, if you want it to mean something, how about loving people? How about serving people? If they don't know that you love them and that you want to serve them, sometimes it's just words. In God's economy, I wrote this down in my notes. In God's economy, the greater you serve someone, the greater influence you will have in their life. 1 Corinthians 9 and verse 10, Paul said this: "Even though I am a free man with no master, I have become a slave to all people." Why? To bring many people to Christ. Here's what Paul said: "I'm expending an energy. I am investing in people. I am serving people." Why? So that I can influence them. Why? Ultimately, to bring people to Christ. This comes back to this understanding. It's like, okay, if I'm going to expend energy as a believer, I want it to be to bring people to Christ more than anything else. Paul is reminding us of that. Jesus told us that if you want to be great in this world, what you need to do is you need to step down and you need to serve. I think this can be a real challenge for younger people coming out of high school. And this is really difficult, and I have a sympathy for this. I mean, I understand how it can be difficult, because when you think about it as a young person, you know, you grow up in a house and your parents are investing in you, pouring into you, doing a lot of serving for you to raise you up, to build you up, to strengthen you. You're in kids' ministry at the church or Sunday school, and the Sunday school teachers are influencing by giving of their time and serving and investing in you. You go into student ministry, and you're at Amped here at our church or another student ministry somewhere else, and the leaders there are investing and they are pouring into you, serving you. Then you graduate from high school, and it's sort of like, okay, flip the switch. Now you go serve people. And that's hard. I get it. That is hard to do. But I want to say to those who are young, you want that investment in being a difference maker to pay off? You've got to figure out how to serve. You got to look at it and say, where is my place in all this? How can I serve people so that I can have opportunities to influence them, especially for the sake of the gospel? Maybe you're a young person and you love kids. Man, it's time to get involved in our kids' ministry. Maybe you loved your experience in student ministry and you want others to be invested in that way through student ministry. You say, you know what? Now I'm going to start giving back into the student ministry or whatever it may be. Serving is so critical. And there's a stewardship thing with this and the way God works in His economy. And this is how it goes. You serve just a few people, God will give you a few people to influence. You serve nobody, God will give you nobody to influence. You serve a lot of people, God will give you a lot of people to influence. That's just how He works this thing. And so I've got to position myself to actually say I want to be in the trenches serving people. You have got to decide if you want to just blab and impress people with your eloquent words or the stand that you're taking, or if you actually care about investing in them. And this is why I don't listen when Hollywood speaks. First of all, you know what they do in Hollywood? You know what actors get paid to do? To be fakers. They're somebody else every time they're on screen. They're not even themselves, and they get paid to do that. So that's not even, some, it's really not always coming from an, and I don't want to make a blanket statement, but I'm just saying in general, when Hollywood speaks, I don't know that they love me, and I don't know, they've never served me, or served, I don't see many of them serving people, you know. In other words, again, I'm not making this a blanket statement. I'm just saying, like, you can have a lot of fame, and you can look really neat in Hollywood, but I'm wanting to listen to influencers who love and serve. And so I hope you will as well. I hope you'll filter that when you're listening to other people in their opinions. Do they love people? Do they serve? Or are they just kind of out there blabbing and blabbing and blabbing? God says, I'm interested in how you want to influence through serving. This is the next thing I wrote. How about being generous? Are you generous? I'm talking, when I say generous, I'm talking about money and possessions here. That's what I'm talking about. I firmly believe, in the scriptures, I believe, back this up over and over, that God gives us opportunities to influence and help others through being generous. And I got to tell you, I respect somebody who loves people and serves people and is generous. Now, I'll listen to people like that. I listen to people who are invested, who model this in their life already. We try to model this as a church for you. You know, we probably don't always get it right, but hey, when you come into the doors at Newalk Church, when you've been live here maybe on our campus or the broadcasts that we invest in online to bring to you, or when you come in and you get the coffee poured and the donuts and pizza served, the donuts and pizza will be back. We're working on that. The resources through our small groups, the things that we do to invest in you, these free things that this is a portrait of generosity. We are, as a church, we are pouring out generously so that we can gain an influence through the things from the stage, what we're sharing with the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are utilizing our generosity to influence people. Do you utilize your generosity to influence people? Proverbs 11:25 says, a generous person will prosper. So we know that. Generous people prosper. Whoever refreshes others will be refreshed. You refresh others through your generosity, you get refreshed as well. But it does say that we can refresh others by being generous. And when we do that, we give out in influence. One of the things I look for when somebody says, Pastor Gary, I want to be a leader in your church, I want to lead here at Newalk, I look and say, okay, are you being generous already? I want to know that heart is there, because that's going to allow you to be a greater influencer if that heart of generosity is already in place. So this goes back again. Let's go back to the 18 to 29-year-old age group, the young adults. And this is a little bit difficult. Some of this is a little bit of a, maybe it's a little bit of a hard medicine, but it's like, okay, you want to speak out. Are you willing to be also a generous person? Again, that switch has got to flip. You know, you get out of school or get out of high school, and all of a sudden now the people that have been generous, and it took generosity to have a kids ministry and a student ministry, and the generosity maybe you grow up in your home environment with your parents supporting you. Now all of a sudden it's got to switch, and you got to be like, okay, now I've got to find my place of generosity. I've got to say, where can I be involved in financially to make a difference? Of course, here at the church, we join our resources together in a generous way to make a difference in all of our community. So that's obviously one place you can have influence and make a difference in. But look, my daddy told it to me like this when I was growing up. You ready? Hey, son, put your money where your mouth is. You're going to talk the talk, you need to walk the walk. That's what I learned. And there's something to it when it comes to being an influencer. Here's the next one. You're going to have to sacrifice. There's sacrifice, and this is not about money, but this is oftentimes really about a physical and emotional thing. Sometimes a pain that you may have to endure in order to be somebody who speaks out, right? Because you understand this, we know this already. If you verbalize something that you're feeling, people will give you kickback. They'll come right at you. And they'll say, people that you care about, friends, loved ones, they'll make a response online or say something to you directly, and it feels hurtful. Now, I've just been laying a foundation to say, okay, you know what, whether it hurts or not for them to hear things, you've at least established a credibility. But in the end, what we understand is that there is a pouring out of yourself that comes with being a leader. Anytime, if anybody in this room or watching online has led, you understand that daggers come your way. You know, you there's a damage that comes. Like, people will say things, they'll do things. It can be harmful sometimes, and you got to be aware of that. You got to be ready for that. In Hebrews 9:14, it says, Jesus Christ was sinless, yet he offered himself as an eternal and spiritual sacrifice to God. That's why his blood is so much more powerful and makes our conscience clear. Now we can serve the living God and no longer do things that lead to death. Hey, look, we can be influencers. We can trust in the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. But Jesus did indeed, as a sinless person, pour out himself on a cross. Here's my question. When Jesus poured himself out on the cross, you understand it was to influence all of humanity for all of human history. That was a great moment of influence. You understand that it was about speaking truth in that moment. When Jesus did that on the cross for the sake of speaking out, being an influencer, and making a difference in this world, did he encounter pain? He did. And I want to tell you, you will as well. You will be bruised. You will be wounded. You will be damaged sometimes when you decide to live the life of being somebody that speaks out. Philippians 2:17, Paul says this, and this is important because Paul is probably one of the top influencers of all of human history as well. I mean, this is, you know, Jesus, and certainly not far there. It's going to be somewhere on the list. It's going to be Paul, but 2/3 of the New Testament is written by Paul. This is a guy who gave himself up physically. He gives himself up physically, emotionally, and relationally. He says this, my life is being poured out as a part of the sacrifice and service that I offer to God for your faith, and yet I am filled with joy. He's saying, I am giving of myself. He's talking about the sacrifice to make a difference in other people's lives. I wrote it down like this. You cannot have great influence without making great sacrifices. If you're going to be an influencer, if you are going to speak out and be a difference maker, you cannot be comfortable. It won't work that way. You've got to be willing to get uncomfortable. Here's the last part of this section that I wanted to give you. And finally, speak out. By speaking out. I wanted to give you all those others as kind of a foundation before we even got to speaking out, because again, I think we like to speak out first. And I wanted to kind of say, let's build some other credibility, but now speaking out. And speaking out is important. And again, as Christians, we ought to be speaking out. In Psalm 107 in verse 2, it says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Yeah, let the believers say so. The believers ought to be people that are speaking out. We should. And again, it's going to be hard because people don't want to hear the truth. You start to speak out and you think, man, you know what? I don't want to offend anybody. You're going to offend. The cross is offensive. It divides light and darkness. It divides the living and the dead. It's a big deal when you speak about the things of Jesus. Let the redeemed say so. As believers, we do say so. We do speak out, but we are better when we have built the credibility to speak out, right? So you're watching online right now. You're watching online, or you're here live, and some of you tune in every week online. You're watching online. Some of you are coming regularly here to the church to hear in a live setting, and here's what we know, that you have decided to listen to me stand up here and blab every week. You're hearing from me. Why? Because I've established some kind of credibility through the way I love, through the way I serve, you know, that through caring, through understanding that I've got to be a generous person, through sacrifice. You've seen that. And so as a person speaking out, speaking truth from the stage, you receive that born out of a level of credibility. But that credibility allows me to stand up and speak about things like racial injustice or social injustice, which we spoke about many weeks ago here from the stage, when I'm speaking out against things like abortion or people that are broken and hurting and need help and coming alongside them. You hear that from me because it comes from a place of credibility. I say so. I'm willing to speak out, but I establish the credibility along the way. But don't hear what I'm not saying, which is that, well, my gosh, before I can ever correct somebody, I got to have all these things in order, and then I'm allowed to speak. No, I'm saying it's healthier that way, but I will say this. There are times when there's not a lot of time, and you need to speak out. You've got a family member who is about to make a decision that's going to go take them off the cliff in life. You need to speak out right then and there. Let the redeemed say so. You got a coworker that's about to make a decision, and you know it's going to lead them into brokenness. You need to speak out. Let the redeemed say so. You've got a neighbor who's about to draw his last breath, and if he doesn't know about Jesus Christ, he's going to spend an eternity in hell. Let the redeemed say so. Step up and speak when the moment comes. I love what Edmund Burke said, and I think some of you have heard this. But it says, the only thing necessary for evil to triumph is for good men to do nothing. The only thing necessary for an entire world to go to hell in a handbasket is for the Christians to do and say nothing. We have to be a people who speak out. We have to be willing to say so. Yes, it's important to build that credibility, but sometimes we've just got to let people, we've got to let them know. We've got to speak up. I love that when we look at the story of Esther in the Old Testament. My goodness, man, all the Jewish people are in exile. They're in this place where we have modern-day Iraq today, and the non-Jewish king Xerxes is there, and he's overseeing all of this, and he decides one day he wants to have a little contest so he can have himself a wife, and this contest happens, and he selects Esther, and Esther now is his wife, and then all of a sudden what we see taking place is this moment of decision by Xerxes. He says, I want to kill all of the Jews in my land. And the Jewish people come to Esther and say, Esther, you are there in this moment for such a time as this. Friends come to her and say, you're in this moment for such a time as this. Use your influence in the position that you are in and your credibility to tell Xerxes, no, don't do this. And she uses that influence, and he decides to spare the Jews. A big moment of influence, a big moment of speaking out, a big moment to say, hey, I have got to make a difference in this setting. I love this translation of Proverbs 31. It says this in verse 8, speak up for someone who cannot speak for themselves. Protect the rights of all who are helpless. Speak for them and protect the rights of the poor and the needy. Here's the third thing I wrote down. You've got to decide to maximize your influence. Maximize. So I said we're going to recognize, we're going to exercise, and then we're going to maximize. Maximize it for the purpose of biblical changing of the heart. So I said at the beginning, the Bible changing, biblical things changing the heart. That's what I'm most interested in. That's what God is interested in. And so now it's sort of a prayer of like, okay, now I'm going through this journey in my life, and I'm doing well with my sphere, but now I want to go beyond that, God. And I pray, God, you would give me more opportunities to influence. Not more opportunities to make myself look good for some self-centered reason, to kind of be in the spotlight because I'm influencing and I know all these people that I get to influence or whatever it may be. It's not for that. That's not what God's interested in. God is interested when you turn to Him and say, God, now give me more opportunity to bring glory to you, God, to tell others about you, God. He then loves that heart, and He will give you opportunities if you've done well with what you had to do more for Him. Anytime you want to advance the cause of the kingdom in a bigger way, God is interested. If you're interested in some self-centered gain for your own glory and your own kingdom, God is not interested in that. On the other hand, I wrote this down in my notes, there is nothing that God will not do for the person whose ultimate goal is to bring glory to God. God puts His hand on that person, and gives them great opportunity to influence and to speak out to people. Ephesians 5:16 says this: make the most of every opportunity for doing good in these evil days. Maximize, make the most of every opportunity. Colossians 4:5, make the most of your chances to tell unbelievers the good news. Be wise in all your contacts with them. Make the most of those opportunities and then be wise with your contacts. And I kind of think being wise with your contacts as a part of that, it's establishing healthy credibility as well. Expanding your influence. It's quite a prayer to turn to God and say, God, give me more opportunity. You know, Solomon does this, and we see about it in Psalm 72. King Solomon, who wisest, smartest, richest, wealthiest man in all of the world, says to God, God, give me more. You might look at that and go, how egotistical is this guy? He's already got everything, and he goes before God, and he says, God, give me more. And God says, you know what? I'm going to give you more. But here's the heart behind it. He will be honest and fair, especially to the poor. The king will rescue and defend the homeless and the hopeless. Do this because the king rescues those who are helpless when they cry out. He helps everyone who is in poor and in need. He will have pity on the weak and he will protect those in need. He cares when they hurt and he saves them from cruel and violent deaths. Let him make the nations prosper. Let your glory, God, be seen everywhere. Let it be seen. God, I'm going to do this. We're going to do this because we're going to bring glory to you, God, everywhere. God's interested in that kind of stuff because it says, I'm going to deal with the poor. I'm going to deal with the neglected. I'm going to deal with the widowed. I'm going to deal with the orphans, the homeless, the helpless, those who have no education, people who can't speak up for themselves. The purpose of godly influence is rich right there with what King Solomon was doing. If you're maximizing what you have, he will give you more to maximize. Don't be found sitting there going, you know, as a believer, I don't have any influence. Uh-uh. You have it. But you got to put it to good use. Let me ask you a question. When you said yes to Jesus Christ, why didn't he just take you to heaven right then and there? Why? I'll tell you why. Because you're left here on this earth to influence. That's why you're here. There's no other reason but the influence. That's the primary goal. That's the primary situation here. To make a difference. When you stand before God one day, he is not going to ask you very difficult questions. Let me give you the first one that I think is going to be the most important. What did you do with my son Jesus Christ? And then the next one is going to be, what did you do with the life that I gave you? I mean, it's in something like this, if we understand the text of the New Testament and what God wants for us as believers. What are you doing right now to influence people around you? It says this in 2 Corinthians 10 and verse 13. Paul said, look, the area of influence that God has assigned to us is to reach you. Now our hope is that as your faith increases and now our area influencing may be greatly enlarged so that we may preach the gospel in the lands beyond you, the global glory of God. What Paul is saying is, you know what, we've done well with you, and now we want more. We got to give us more opportunity to bring glory to you. God, what are you doing with your influence, with the talent you have, with the time you have, with the money you have, with the relationships you have, with the opportunities that God has given you, with the freedom that you have in this country to preach and teach and share the gospel with people around you? What are you doing with that, with the intelligence God gave you, with the contacts, the network that you have in your life? How are you utilizing that? If you're watching online, you're here live, would you pray with me? God, let us not be found saying we have no influence. God, would you do a fresh questioning of us right now? What is in your hand? Ask us, what is in our hand? What do we have now that we can make a difference with? We so many causes, there's so many things that could be a part of and speak out against, and they're so nice, but what do we have now in front of us that we can be influencing in to make a difference in this world? God, I believe my prayer would be that you would show people watching online and here in our audience even greater influence, but we got to do well with what we have now. In the name of Jesus Christ, Father, I pray that you would show us more, give us more as we do well with what we have. I'm praying for the person that's watching online or right here in our live setting that does not know you, and I wonder if they're aware of the amount of times they were influenced by people around them to know Jesus. That all-important question, what did you do with my son Jesus? And there are people watching or maybe online, they were in Sunday school one day, or they were at student ministry one day, or they grew up going to church, or somebody told them about Jesus. All they wanted to do was influence you to know Jesus. And maybe right now you're saying just in your mind, you know what, it's time to receive that influence that somebody poured into me so that I can be a difference maker in this world. God, I'm ready to turn to you. I bend a knee. I surrender my heart to you, God. I believe in your one and only Son, Jesus Christ, his death, burial, and resurrection, that what he did on the cross was so I might be forgiven of my sin, be set free, and make a difference with my life in this world. I'm ready, God, to have eternal life. I surrender to you, God. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Hey, online, thanks for watching. Thanks for being with us. Those of you watching live, thanks for being with us. We'll be right back.